Elephant with two tails. Crowded, aren't you?
She'll take eight at a pinch.
She's what we'll probably get.
I don't mind. Might as well get pinched in a car and squeezed in a box.
Yes, they're fine, Cornelia. But why?
Why what?
Well, why does my best model suddenly want to become a photographer?
Because your best model is rapidly approaching 30 and doesn't want to end up modeling twin sets and knitting magazines.
Oh, come on. That's a long way off.
And before that happens, I want to get a new career. Is that so unreasonable?
No, but it's...
Right! Check your makeup, ladies. We're all going to be film stars.
Well, he's been acting like one for years. Jim, you know cameras.
You could say, yeah.
What am I doing wrong?
You don't need it. I thought you were a model.
I'm changing over.
To this?
You're not going to warn me off too, are you?
No. I've known some good cameramen, all birds. What do you know about it?
Nothing.
I'll give you the tour of the darkroom.
I'd like that. If you really mean the darkroom.
Yeah. I mean, you're serious?
Yes. Can you teach me developing and all that?
Sure. And I've got this watch that will light up in the dark.
Only the watch?
You don't think we should join them?
Do you want to?
No. What sort of a bloke is he?
After a week, you don't know.
No.
Mm-hmm. That's the sort of bloke he is. Why?
The Rock seems to be getting involved.
You getting proprietorial?
I don't own people.
No. No, I can see that. What's she going to do with all this new material? Shops, unemployment lines?
Lit up a good show. Kate's always do.
She's gunning for him, isn't she?
That's her style. If you don't want to get gunned for, you don't agree to do a show with her.
Well, then why do people agree?
Everyone thinks I'm different. Everyone thinks I'm the exception. She won't be able to touch me.
That's what Saxon thought. There are bullets she's using.
Corny, if you want to be a good cameraman, then stay remote. You can't have attitudes. You shoot what's there. So how bright is he?
Very.
Then he knew what he was going into.
I'm quitting.
So am I, Kate.
What you did to Saxon last night was disgusting.
He didn't have that coming to him.
I told you, Corny. You've got to be detached if you want to be a professional.
A professional what?
Why did you come back?
How do you mean?
The first time I asked for a lift, you drove off.
don't care if the place is a rat hole.
All right. Sergeant White's on the telephone.
I'm not taking any calls and I'm not seeing anybody.
Hey, I'm school.
You keep on saying that.
I'd like to drop the charge. You remember me, don't you?
Mrs. Upton?
That's right.
Afraid it's out of your hands, huh?
It's my car.
Yes, but an offence has been committed.
Well, can't you change one of the questions about permission to drive or something?
No.
Well, how about filling in a new form? That's ridiculous.
It's the law.
And the law is ridiculous. What are they doing? Well, I mean, is he getting the third degree or what?
Well, if you're in a hurry, Mrs. Upton.
I'll wait. You hoping I'll change my mind?
Any other charges?
Just illegal use and dangerous driving.
He's a very lucky fella. Mrs. Upton's off to go his bail for him. You hear what I said? Well, at least you can say is thank you.
Yes, well, how do we go about that? You're a good driver.
His mum.
Mr. Smith. Where have you been?
Oh. Thanks for letting me drive.
It's all right. Peter? Look, I know you've got a good job already, but... well, some of the fences around my place are falling down. Well, I just thought you might like to earn some extra money in your spare time.
Yeah. I'll see what I can do. Thanks. Okay.
It's beautiful. You must be thirsty.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks.
Well, in case you get bored.
Oh, thanks.
Do you know how to work it?
Yeah, well, it shouldn't be too hard.
Did you see the tree?
Yeah, it's nice. Why did you put up the bail for me, Mrs. Upton?
Why does one do anything?
Yeah. It's nice and peaceful here.
It's like a graveyard.
The car could do with a bit of a clean-up.
Everything here could do with a bit of a clean-up.
What do you want?
You didn't go.
I want to stay here as long as I can.
Peter, whatever you got mixed up in last night, it doesn't make any difference. Do you understand? Well, I'll still help you when you come out.
It'll be years.
Oh, they'll pass.
How?
Somehow.
Couldn't you say I was here last night? You'll forget about me.
No.
You want a bet?
Oh, I promise. I'll go and call the police. No, Peter, please don't. Please, let me go.
Well, you're trying to make a fool of me?
No, I never thought.
What, do you think I'm blind?
Oh, go away.
Oh, well, who'd want you anyway?
Aren't you going to deny it, say you didn't know anything about it?
Perhaps I don't always do the standard thing.
Let me tell you something about myself, Mr. Donovan, on or off the record. That sort of thing always makes me think, one, someone obviously has a very good organizational brain. Two, you have to go to all that trouble, why is it necessary? And three, what are they trying to cover up?
Doctor, believe it or not, it wasn't my idea, so I can't tell you. But if you have any other questions.
Oh, doesn't it? Well, if there is an analogy, I prefer to think of it as akin to the work of a surgeon. Sometimes he has to cut out infected tissue to make the body well again. Sometimes the patient dies. Well, even the best surgeons can make mistakes. And sometimes he's too late. And what he uncovers is malignant. There's nothing he can do about it, no matter how deep he cuts. Rita?
You've seen us.
Hardly surprising.
Eat your heart out, Thomas.
Hello, Thomas.
Hello, Barbara.
And how are you, Tom?
Very well, thanks, Barb.
How's little Jimmy? Still as introverted as ever, I see. And how's the good wife, Patricia?
Home. Trying on a new dress, as a matter of fact. I bought it in town for her yesterday. $150. Carrying Walter's bags now.
He's in talking to Grandfather.
Some of us see him every day.
Well, at least some of us visit him purely socially. Any celebrations planned? Well, that's why Walter insisted that we come down to see you all at once and celebrate the centenary. Walter, darling, this is a social occasion. You've got to stop talking shop.
Barbara, as long as I can remember, talking shop meant two blokes in the same job getting together after work and nattering about the job. That doesn't apply here. I'm no bloody solicitor. I hate the beggars.
Well, of course you do. But you should be proud that your grandson's one of the best in business. And how is my favorite granddad?
Only one you got. Not much of a choice, is it?
Well, I still love you madly.
Doctors put him on a diet.
Oh, well, perhaps that's for the best.
And I eat what I like when I like.
Of course you do. So you should. My diet's a dehydrated fooey. I saw Thomas outside. How is he?
Thomas, okay, why didn't you ask him yourself?
Oh, I did. Is he still saving up for a property of his own?
Says he is.
Is he making it?
Says he is.
Poor old Thomas. He's always trying to make a big impression. Still, if he does make it, he'll have Patricia to thank.
Yes, maybe you're right. Go on.
Pardon?
She should never have married him.
Aha, so you do agree with me.
Walter and I should have put our foot down.
Well, whose idea was it to come up here anyway?
It's the old boy's messing us about. He's senile.
Don't you believe it, my love. Well, we're in a nice mess now.
Inviting Gary Hogan.
He's an old family friend.
That old man's playing games with us.
What's your bad, Walter?
Gary.
Well, tell me about your job. Last time we saw you, you just had a promotion.
Oh, yeah. It keeps me busy.
Oh, that's what Walter always says.
Yeah.
After lunch, we're all going to be sitting around the table and drawing up my will between us. My family can choose what they want, and Gary here will adjudicate for me.
Granddad, Walter's the solicitor. I mean, he can draw up a will.
Oh, I hate bloody solicitors.
Well, I'm not so ungracious as to not to take advantage of Grandpa's opportunity to swoop like a pack of vultures. You're the one who's trying to embarrass you, stupid woman. Walter?
Never a truer word said.
Oh, Tom's as bad, Pat. Can't criticize my wife while your husband's sitting there with dollar signs in his eyes.
Well, you don't have to stay, do you?
No, I don't. Excuse me, Grant.
Excuse me, Grant. Emily? Well, now you know who really appreciates you, Grandpa. Mm. This land, how many acres?
Oh, 2,000.
No way. I'm the farmer around here. I'll put the land to good use. What would a solicitor
want
with a...
You're a farm labourer. You're not a farmer. You can't even buy your wife a decent dress. How are you going to go about spending thousands of dollars on livestock?
Oh, come on, Grandad. Make us see reason.
We are allied through circumstances. I think a truce is called for.
Oh, sir?
Well, I don't want the whole stupid estate.
Or me.
I'd like a little over half.
So would I.
Which totals 1.5.
Not including anybody else.
I think you're with me. But it's simple.
Good morning, Liz.
Good morning, Mrs. Maxwell.
Come in and sit down.
We didn't know if you'd be here.
And now that I am,
it's nice to see you.
I understand you've moved into his office.
Well, somebody had to keep things going.
Yes. I should have waited until we buried him, but you always were an ambitious girl.
Mrs. Maxwell, I did what I thought best. I can't see what difference it makes to Philip if I sit behind his desk or I dance on his coffin.
Sit down. You're going to the funeral, Jimmy tells me.
Well, if you have no objection, yes.
No, I have no objection. I may need a friendly arm to lean on.
I've seen worse. It's a bit small at the moment. As the actress said to the bishop, great oaks from little acorns grow.
Good morning, Nurse Adams.
Don't you ever sleep, sister?
I wouldn't, if all my nurses lived it up the way you do.
Have you any complaints about my work?
No, nurse, only your morals. I think you should examine your conscience. Nursing requires a certain amount of dedication. And if you're not prepared to give it, I suggest you concentrate on whatever else it is you do best.
Sister Scott, the only thing that would make me give up nursing at the moment is the thought of turning into a vinegary old maid.
Well, you look lovely, Grace.
Like every bride should look.
A new life, Grace.
Yes.
What time is it?
Well, you're going to be fashionably late.
Not too late.
No, you won't be too late.
I'll get it. Hello, Sister Scott's room. Yes, she is, but... Who? Well, hold on a moment, please. It's your father.
Hello. Hello, Dad. Where is she? Yes, that's right. Yes, today, in a few moments, in fact. Well, yes, it all happened quite suddenly, really. Yes, all right. Hello, Mother. Yes, that's right. Yes, well, look, I'll write you along later in a couple of weeks or so. Look, I really haven't got time to talk any... Well, he's a very nice man. He's in business, actually. Yes. Yes, all right. Well, I really have to go now. Goodbye.
Do you, Les, take this woman, Grace, to be your wedded wife? And do you, in the presence of God and before this congregation, promise and covenant to be to her a loving, faithful, and dutiful husband until God shall separate you by death?
I'm sorry, Grace, I can't get through with it.
If Sister Scott saw me, she'd have something to say. Now, they don't call the dragon lady for nothing.
Indeed, they do not. I'm just on my way to personnel. Maybe I should have a word with them about you. Now, this is a hospital, Nurse Gordon, not a lonely huts club. Get back to your work.
Yes, sister. I'm sorry, sister.
Well, Angela told me most of this when I agreed to take on the case, but I had to hear it from you.
Miss Saunders?
Carmel.
Carmel. Please don't think I'm not grateful for all the work you're putting into my case.
What?
Well, today is David's preliminary hearing, and I wish you'd just concentrate on that. How's it going?
Oh, as well as can be expected, I'm afraid.
And how's he? He's not taking it too hard, is he?
Well, he's bearing up. He seems resigned. Now, Fat, I'm sorry, but we really must talk about your appeal.
My appeal? My appeal won't be worth tuppence once Herbie makes his statement in there.
What possible damage could his statement do you?
Well, what if he said that I saw David before that gunfight?
What are you talking about? I've got a copy of his statement. There's no mention of a prior meeting in here. Don't worry, Pat. We're going to come through this with flying colours.
Well, I'd like to start as soon as possible.
Yeah, I'll clear it with Mrs. Davidson as soon as she gets back. Oh, Carmel, sorry to keep you waiting.
Well, well, Miss Saunders. Still champion of the underdog.
Yes, you too, I understand. How are you, Mr. Pierce?
Very well, thanks.
Mr. Fletcher's just gone to get Pat.
Fine, fine.
I'll see you soon, Paul.
Yeah.
You too, probably.
No doubt. Bye.
All right, let's go and see if we can convince Pat O'Connell.
Hello, Pat.
Miss Saunders.
Thank you, Miss Bennett.
Has something gone wrong?
Wrong?
With the appeal.
Oh, no. No, I just want to go through the procedure again before we go to court tomorrow. And the way you handle yourself is going to be very important. I'm sorry, sit down. Now then, as you know, the appeal is being heard before a bench of the Supreme Court. Now, there'll be three judges. One will argue in favor of your case and one against it.
Sounds as if they've already made up their minds.
No, no, that's just normal procedure. I mean, no new evidence can be produced. It's a legal argument. Was your trial influenced by the publicity surrounding it, or wasn't it?
And we have to prove that it was.
I know all that. It's not very likely, is it?
It's possible. Pat, as I said before, your behaviour in court tomorrow is going to be vital to your case. Now, you go in with that attitude and we haven't got a hope. Well, look, if you don't want to think of yourself, shouldn't you think of your children? I mean, you've got to give them a chance.
Maybe they've got more chance in the home.
I've put a lot of work into this case, Pat, an awful lot. Now, it'll all go for nothing if you lose your cool in there. Do you understand?
Good luck, love. Don't let those barristers get you down. Remember, we're going to beat them, okay? Right. Yes, I understand.
Well, kids, here we come, eh? Mrs. O'Connell, would you please tell the court briefly of the circumstances surrounding the crimes for which you were originally sentenced?
Yes. My husband, Eric, did an armed hold-up. He took Davy along with him. I didn't know about it until it was too late.
And then they returned to your home after the crime?
Yes. Well, it was their home, too.
Quite. And subsequently, you hid their presence from the police and helped them get away from the city?
Yes.
And after that, you were arrested and sentenced to 5 years for aiding, abetting, and accessory after the fact of armed robbery.
Yes.
Mrs. O'Connell, you have two other children, do you not?
Yes, Andrew and Emma.
And what happened to these children at the time of your arrest?
My mother looked after them.
Are they still with your mother?
No. They had to go to a home. My mother's sick. She had to have an operation. And she found the kids were getting a bit too much for her. Oh, not that they're bad kids, Your Honor. They're just normal kids.
Mrs. O'Connell, we understand you have now divorced your husband.
Yes, Your Honor. Miss Jeffries thought it best.
Miss Jeffries?
Miss Angela Jeffries, Your Honor, an associate of mine. She acted on behalf of Mrs. O'Connell during the divorce proceedings.
Oh, yes. Miss Jeffries. Why did she think it was best?
Mr. O'Connell has a long list of convictions, Your Honor, and much as my client loved her husband, she was rather afraid of the influence he might have over her children. Yet another unhappy event in her life brought about through circumstances.
I see. It would seem Mrs. O'Connell has had her fair share of the inequities of life. Miss Saunders, we've heard enough, really, to be able to consider our decision on this case. Is there any other relevant point you wish to raise?
There is one, Your Honor, yes. My client's husband, Eric O'Connell, was convicted of armed robbery, to which my client was an accessory, and sent to Pentridge. 2 weeks ago, he was released on parole. Does it not seem iniquitous that the man who perpetrated the crime has paid his debt to society, whilst the one person acknowledged to have been involved only peripherally is still being punished?
That is indeed a good point, Miss Saunders, and one which we will consider in our deliberations. This court shall adjourn for 1 hour.
This Supreme Court will adjourn for 1 hour. Silence, all stand.
It seems to be going all right, don't you think?
Yes, but don't be too confident.
But the judge said I'd been through a lot, and when you told them about Eric...
Pat, you've been convicted and sentenced. Now, for the judges to alter that sentence means, in effect, that they're admitting one of their colleagues was wrong, and they do not like to do that. The law, at least, must be seen to be unified.
The law.
I only turned 65 once. You might at least put yourself out a little.
I came here. Isn't that enough?
I am not 10 years old now, Mother. That sort of turn won't wash anymore.
I'm just getting over a heart attack, Barbara. I mustn't be upset.
Oh, don't try that one on. If you're well enough to hold this little bash this evening, you are well enough to take no as an answer from me.
Well, it's such a petty thing to dig your heels in over.
Well, then why are you digging your heels in? You have to have everything your own way all the time, don't you?
Maybe we should go outside.
No, don't bother. Stay.
Are you getting some kick out of being so stubborn? Is that why you agreed to come?
I came here because you're my husband's business partner, you know. Damn well, that's the only reason. If you want me, I shall be upstairs.
Don't you walk out on me. I haven't finished.
Well, I have.
I'm your mother, for God's sake. It's my birthday. I don't see that that's too much to ask.
You stopped being my mother years ago. The day my father died. So don't come that one with me either.
Because you've never forgiven yourself for killing him, don't you keep taking it out on me. His death was your fault, and you know it. And that's why you can't stand being around me, because I know it too. Now, I just want you to promise me one thing. Oh, it's her life. And if she's happy with Wayne, you mustn't stand in her way. Can I have your word on that? If she's content, you have no right to continue making trouble.
If she genuinely wants to marry Wayne, I shall bow out gracefully. I'll also eat my hat and everybody else's for that matter.
But you do promise.
Yes. Marrying Wayne? I have never heard such nonsense.
Well, why not? I want to. Well, I'm really happy about it.
Oh, happy about the money, more likely.
Of course I'm happy about that. That's the main reason we're doing it.
I think you're both sick.
Well, there's no reason we can't be as happy as anyone supposedly marrying for love. Besides, I like Wayne. Well, who knows? I might even end up loving him.
Well, you're doing a pretty good job of convincing yourself.
I've made my mind up, if that's what you mean. So if you've come all the way over here to try and change it, you've wasted your time.
Amanda, don't you think you should give the whole thing a lot more thought?
We're getting married, and that's all there is to it.
Don't you walk away from me, young lady.
Barbara, you promised.
Oh, I thought you were so sick in bed.
I'm just making sure that you keep your word.
The girl is obviously lying.
You're seeing what you want to see, Barbara. Now, you made a promise, and I expect you to keep it.
You've tricked me once too often, Mother. I'm going.
Oh, come on, dear.
Oh, all that talk after the party about how you and I were going to get back together. Well, you could forget that for a start.
Barbara.
And how frightened you were of dying. My God, I'm not surprised, because when you come to do it, you'll be doing it totally alone. I'd like to throw her out, but of course, if you'd like to talk...
Of course I don't.
Things would be a lot easier if you weren't hovering.
Oh, excuse me, you barged your way into my home. I'm staying put.
If we're going to have a domestic, I think we ought to have it at home.
Is that what you think this is, a domestic tiff? We're splitting up, Patricia. I'm not going to change my mind, so you may as well leave.
But it's all come out of nowhere.
It's been building up for months.
I was only trying to help you.
Well, I don't want your help anymore. Now, go home. You're just making a fool of yourself.
All right. You're so weak, I'm probably better off without you. Oh, don't look so smug. Has he told you who Andrew's mother is yet?
Patricia.
It's obviously a big mystery. I don't know what it is. Her name's Helen Green. Ring any bells? Ah, I can see that it does. Oh. Explain your way out of that one, darling.
I can explain, Bobby.
Well, it had better be damned good.
I'm glad you could make it. It'll mean a lot to Ruth.
I can't say I'm entirely happy about her choice of husband. She could have done a lot better for herself.
I don't know. Frank's a decent enough bloke. I'll be pleased to call him son.
He's a small-town boy with no future.
Oh, there you go. You haven't even met him yet.
I don't have to.
You and I must see the world different, I reckon.
Yeah, that was painfully obvious when you married Elsa. Should we go in?
Ah, Morag. Nice to see you.
Hello, Celia.
It's been too long.
Yes, it has. You're looking well.
I feel it.
Oh, Ruth, darling.
Hi, Annie Morag.
How's my favourite girl?
I'm okay.
You looking forward to the big day?
Yeah.
Well, good for you.
Hello, I'm Elsa.
Hello.
Face to face at last.
Yes.
Well,
Who's hungry? I've got the place stocked to the rafters.
No need. I'm taking you all out to dinner.
Oh, no. That's far too expensive. And besides, there's a roast almost ready.
No meat and three veg tonight. We're going to eat in style.
Do we have to?
Yes. I want the best restaurant in Summer Bay. If that's not a contradiction of terms.
Oh, you'd be surprised. There's a few new joints open serving that classy French tucker.
Oh, and you've actually ventured into them?
Yes, unfortunately. Big on price, small on tucker. A couple of snow peas artistically arranged around a sprig of parsley isn't my idea of 20 bucks worth.
Your father's been too long in Summer Bay.
I keep trying to tell him that, but he just won't listen.
Oh, he's like that. The life that you want,
so she'll be happy.
What can you offer her? The town spinster who lives by proxy. You live through everybody else because you've got no life of your own. I mean, I can offer her the world, Celia. I can introduce her to influential people.
She is not your daughter.
She is not yours either.
But she is Alfred's, and she's going to need
Alfred
her family.
Alfred is married
to a very decent woman.
To an ex-con who murdered her father.
He was a terrible man.
Oh, now don't tell me you condone murder too.
Of course not, but there are certain facts which change the way...
The fact is that Alfred threw Ruth out. The fact is that he is married to a woman I do not want influencing Ruth, and the fact is that you are a desperately lonely woman who will not accept that your niece wants to live with me and not with you.
You are impossible.
Thanks for dropping by, Celia. I do so enjoy our little battle. Sorry. Talks. Next time you want to get in touch, though, please don't. There's a good girl.
You could at least look at me when you speak to me. Well?
Oh, good God, what do you think you look like? Dame Edna Everidge on a bad day, or a tea cosy.
I might have known you'd fire off some spiteful remark. Can't help yourself, Morag, can you?
Not when you give me such good ammunition, no.
A little of the green-eyed monster, if you ask me.
Me? Jealous of you? Miss Summer Bay Spinster? Oh, for heaven's sake, Celia, grow up.
How dare you be so thoroughly rude? I never make nasty remarks to you.
Well, I don't happen to wear the Queen Mother's cast-offs. And as for your coiffure, you'd be quite within your rights to sue the hairdresser for damages. I'll even act on your behalf, if you like. You can make money with that look. Hire yourself out to the church for a floral arrangement.
How dare you insult me in my own home?
Our home?
The sooner you move out to that Blaxland place, the better. Sister or not, Morag, you are a vicious, sarcastic woman. You don't care who you hurt. And you can't find a nice word to say about anyone.
And you can't take a joke, Celia, which is ironic. Because you are a joke.
I am not. I am a warm-blooded, sensitive, feminine woman. And it is time that you and the rest of Summer Bay realizes that and takes me seriously.
First of all, I'd like to thank you all very much for coming tonight and to helping me celebrate the reopening of one of the town's finest old properties. Oh, and my homecoming, I could call it. You know, the journey back into one's past is a very interesting one. It helps one recall one's humble origins and how one overcame them. Well, not that this house has any particular memories for me. I mean, the house that does that is already occupied by my sister. Keeper of all local folk history, or gossip, as I usually call it. You know, becoming reacquainted with one's family after so many years is a very, well, it's a very reassuring thing to know that absolutely nothing has changed. How comforting to know that my dear brother Alfred hasn't altered one jot since he turned 16. Well, the only discernible difference being his lovely if absent wife, who could so easily be confused with his lovely if absent first wife. So, looking around and seeing all these old faces, it's very interesting to know just how much one can recall. Oh, a lot of it best forgotten, no doubt. But then this is a night for recollection, so, well, let's just remember, shall we? What a pillar of the community, Donald. Oh, if only they knew. You know, for as long as I can remember, you have personified respectability. Upheld the moral fibre of the town, one could say. Such an onerous responsibility, and one fraught with money one cannot afford to make a single slip. Oh, now, I am living proof of that. And it's quite extraordinary the penalty one has to pay for a single, small mistake. And such an unworthy mistake. But of course, in my day, one was compelled to produce one's mistake. But of course, these days, there's a very civilized solution to getting rid of the problem. what a pity I didn't discover it until it was too late.
Bobby.
What a salutary midlife surprise you were. Oh, not only for me, of course, it does take two. You did, and you still do have a father.
Help! Help!
No, it wasn't like that. It wasn't anything like that. I told Richard I was pregnant. But he knew the baby couldn't be his because he was infertile and he'd never admitted it to me. He wanted me to get rid of it, to kill it. I couldn't. So I pretended to have an operation. And of course I didn't. I just went away.
And had Bobby in secret.
Martha was the only one who knew. And I never told her about Richard, about what he'd said or about what he wanted me to do. I just pretended he didn't know, and that was the lie. Richard never forgave me. He felt he wasn't a man. He was my husband in name only. Oh, we were the perfect couple. Charming, social, brilliant. He never tarnished me again. And I loved him so much. So much. Now do you understand why that girl ruined my life?
Yes. Now I understand. Good morning, Morag. Morag? Some idiot shifted the chair. Ow! Morag, this is childish. Morag? Morag, what have you done to the room? Morag, I know you're there. Morag, have you gone mad? Morag!
And what is it to be about this lecture, I take it, I'm about to receive?
It's about you. About you and Summer Bay, actually.
Oh, yes.
Yes. I think you're right. I think it is time you left. You have wreaked enough pain and anguish upon everyone. Why, Morag? Why did you do it? Does the judge wish to be judged, to be sentenced? Is that it? Well, whatever it is, you finally succeeded. Everyone hates you. Is that what you wanted?
Oh, I've no intention of getting hurt, Donald. By anyone.
You are the weakest link. Goodbye.
You look fabulous.
Oh, yes, I do, don't I? Trailer park life certainly agrees with me. See, my goodness.
Well, it's been
forever and a day.
G'day, Colin. Good to see you.
Oh, lovely to see you, Alf. Oh, I've missed you. I've missed everybody. Well, just about everybody. How are you, Morag? Now, not even your sour tongue can spoil today.